name is Mario Tapia. I've been running MobileMonday events like this for about 16 years. So it's been over 300. Tonight, we're going to look at, essentially we have an awesome panel. I'll tell you a little bit about Felipe. Felipe has really gone from zero to almost 35 million Facebook followers in 12 months. That's 2 hours. So more followers than Groupon, YouTube. It's actually amazing. Rafael is actually, what are you guys? He is over almost a 10-year MobileMonday person as a developer. Him and his wife and a couple other folks MobileMonday started, which is All the Cooks, which is still the number one app after 4 years in the app stores. Amazing growth, almost 50 million downloads. And it's him and his wife, and they were acquired for double-digit millions last year. Great team. So he'll share a little bit about how he's able to grow. And also, Will Harbin from Kixeye also talk about the gaming side. So basically, we have Felipe kind of representing e-commerce. We have Rafael talking about kind of a B2C community. And then Will be talking about something about gaming. So it's the secrets of hyper growth and engagement. And hashtag is MobileMonday, it'd be like MobileMonday and pound growth. Good. How many people here first night, or first time MobileMonday? Wow. How many people here have been to a MobileMonday in the past here in Silicon Valley? A MobileMonday in a different city. All right. Cool. So I'm helping curate three different cities, and MobileMonday is pretty big. It's like 140 cities. So I've been curating Silicon Valley since like 2009, Los Angeles, started that group in 2006, and then inherited New York in June. So now I've been trying to connect the three different cities with, we definitely are tech here in the Valley. New York is a lot of ad tech and fintech technologies. In LA, definitely entertainment and tech technologies. We're a 501c6 nonprofit, and you can kind of see the rest of the US cities. How many people have been to one of these other cities that I have on there? All right. So, just like tonight, around the world, probably quite a few other MobileMondays happening. And just between the three different cities, we're about 30,000. So, pretty much. My spammy newsletter. How many people got my newsletter, by the way? How many people think I'm spamming you? Is it weekly or
yeah, keep it coming.
Every month. So basically, I try to get a pace of every Monday of what's happening. Please send me if there's events and stuff like that. I want to grow at least the list of events that focus on mobile. And so over the years, I always ask you, like, so what do you guys do if you signed up on, I think, Splash that, you probably get all these questions. So how many people here are developers, people who write code? And then product and marketing. Is product and marketing, wow, okay. Business development, externally focused sales, cool. And then, we're the unicorn designers. There's like one, there's one! One or two. So there's always a few, which is great. And then, any bloggers? Media? There's also venture, VC guys. Alright, cool. So for first timers, this is kind of a breakdown. This is our monthly meetup. So this is like everybody, general topic, panel session, right? To educate you. The MobileMonday Labs is our technical session. So that actually we copied from Sao Paulo in Brazil, who's a group down there says, hey, we love the business, we love the product marketing stuff, can you support tech? And so we do some deep dives on the tech side. APIs, SDKs. So basically, if you have an API or SDK that you want to educate and evangelize about, that's what the dev labs do. And then we do our CXO dinners. So I don't know, has anybody here been to one of our CXO dinners? A couple. So it's what we do, yeah. Yeah, so it's about 25 people. It's every other month. And we focus on a certain vertical topic. And we kind of have what we discuss in that room, students in that room. but it's kind of, we had some really good deep dives on the industry. And then finally, we experimented a little bit with Mobile University, which I always thought, like, and that would be like, what if Mobile Monday was all day, right? So we were practicing with that. Definitely a lot of Fortune 500, but also a lot of startups. How many people here are in a startup? Like less than 10 people, less than 50. Yeah, wow. So San Francisco. And then many of you will find, okay, well, I'm first time here, how do I find out more? So MobileMonday.us is a great place to start. Our Twitter is MobileSB, our Facebook is MobileMonday Silicon Valley. So basically Twitter and Facebook are more about events and happenings, announcements. And then YouTube, so this is being recorded tonight. So we have about almost 6 years, the last 6 years have been documented and put on YouTube. So you can go back to tons of awesome topics that we've talked about in the past. And the other one is, I'd like to thank also our event sponsors. So give a round of applause to CleverTap, and thank you guys. CleverTap will be giving a kind of a keynote overview, a bit of acquisition engagement. And Ifly's also gonna, we'll have Steve, your CMO, and come on up and let's say a little bit about.
Thanks, Mario. Hey, everybody, welcome.
Thank you.
We're thrilled and delighted to have you standing here tonight. Mobile Mondays are one of our favorite groups to have in the house, and we have a great turnout tonight. So I'm Steve Sutter, VP Marketing here at the week. If you're not familiar with us, we own and operate some of the world's most successful and popular social networks, including Tag.com and High Five. We also build new social apps all around social discovery, dating applications, we have social gaming applications. We're about 120 people here based here in San Francisco in this building. And we are hiring. We're looking for mobile product managers as well as mobile developers, Android and iOS. So Tom is here with us from our talent group as well as myself. Come up and say hello. And we are just absolutely thrilled to have you again here in the evening. I'm glad the peach is here as well. And I've been looking forward to this particular panel all month because this is an amazing all-star group cast of people. So it should be a great evening. Thanks again. Welcome. Have a great evening. Enjoy.
So I'd like to call up, thanks Steve, and it looks like that I can smell the pizza, so so if you guys are want to grab a slice, it's really, really thick, good pizza. Want to introduce Monica from CleverTap, and she's going to talk a bit more about what CleverTap does, and we also have a video. You want to pull the video first?
Presenting CleverTap, the next-gen platform that redefines engagement for your mobile app. Engage up to 1 million people per month in your app, absolutely free. Build one app offering multiple experiences with our naked API, offering code-level access. Invite your valued customers to take the actions you want with our prescriptive pre-built campaigns. Integrate our SDK in 30 minutes and enjoy world-class analytics, targeted notifications, and unified user profiles. CleverTap, making apps smarter.
Hi everyone, I'm Monica Fuker and I'm with CleverTap and I'm the product evangelist for CleverTap. And so thank you all for joining us today. We also have Malcolm, who's our CMO here, and we have Jay on our marketing team, and Sean Yasser, that's our head of content. So we're really excited to partner with Mobile Monday to talk about growth and get engagement in app. And you know, thank our panelists for also lending it some conversation to this panel in a bit. So I wanted to quickly go over what the potential opportunity is with app developers, and a bunch of you, it sounds like, are in different segments of the businesses, are in startups and are in larger businesses. So you know, with that in mind, let's talk about what kind of the opportunity. We know that the opportunity is vast. Mobile is not going anywhere, and 80% of time is spent on mobile devices is spent in app, and that number is growing. Last year was 86% in apps, while web fell 14%, and the download numbers are staggering, and by 2017, the projections are going to be about 268 billion apps downloaded. So there's a huge opportunity in this marketplace. We know that that's grand, but the real opportunity right now that we're seeing is in-app engagement and how do you retain those users once they're in-app. So the old model was, how do we acquire users? How do we acquire users as fast as possible? And that's going to be the only metric that we're focusing in on. And today we're really seeing that the attention in the new generation model is going towards how do we really engage and participate and retain these users while they're in app. So there's a bunch of different challenges that remain. 20% of your users open your app only once. 70% of those users are disengaged by day three. And by the third month in, 90% uninstall and become active users. And this is across the board with Android and iOS. This is from Quetra, but you see that really the opportunity lies within the first 7 days of somebody downloading your app. So within 7 days, you have a very, very short limited window of retaining those users and making sure that your acquisition costs are not increasing because people are disengaging or even uninstalling your apps. And we're seeing that this trend is decreasing, actually. So you would think that because there are retention tools out there, that this would decrease over time, but the number of app installs has increased, and so you're seeing retention rates actually go down. So the greatest challenge facing mobile today is retention and engagement, and it's such a hot topic right now with mobile. And we are here to serve that challenge. Our platform, CleverTap, our platform provides the value and the tools and the tools necessary to retain and engage users in app. So a little bit about CleverTap. We're funded by Sequoia and Excel. We've been around for about 2 years. And we recently did a launch at TechCrunch and Disrupt. So we have about 1,000 customers in 58 countries. We work cross-platform, and we've done about, we concurrently do about a billion push notifications per month and 5 billion user actions tracked each month. So to combat some of these problems that we were discussing earlier, we've built Clever campaigns. In Clever campaigns, we've pre-built 6 Clever campaigns so that if you don't have the resources necessary and you are launching your app, you can engage with users within the first day of launching your app. So we want retention and engagement not to be an afterthought. After you've developed your app and you ship it to the App Store, we want it to be at the forefront of discussions and your strategy as you're shipping to the App Store. So we've pre-built 6 custom campaigns that you can use out of the box. So once you integrate the SDK, you can utilize these 6 pre-built campaigns to push targeted notifications out to your user from day one. All right, so to target users, we can offer highly personalized offerings. So you can segment your database of users and target offers to loyal customers. These can range from anything. You've probably received many of these push notifications in your apps today. But the key is really to target those users. So not to do a shotgun approach and send one notification to everyone that might not be highly personalized. So you can segment your database of users and target loyal customers or target highly personalized offerings to get those retention metrics increased. We also have the ability to do unified user profiles, so across web and mobile, you're able to have one centralized user profile that will track everything from user actions to historical interactions, demographics, campaign visits, and transaction history. In turn, what we're seeing is that this is really driving customer loyalty and increasing your LTV over the lifetime of the customer. So everything in CleverTap is real-time, omni-channel, like I said before, and fast. So you can do targeted notifications through email, through web, and through mobile, and you can also track uninstalls and re-engage through those channels as well. And along with Clever campaigns, we did introduce our naked API, so to dig in a bit deeper, we allow you programmatic access to create a dynamic, customized app experience. So you can do that based on different attributes and really truly customize the in-app experience for your users. So based on their user profile demographics. So, you know, you're a woman, you're in San Francisco, you might be served a different in-app experience than a man living in San Francisco. So you can really truly create very customized app experiences and then also use targeted notifications. So three steps to getting started. One is obviously to download the CleverTap SDK, push your app to the App Store, and you can get started running Clever campaigns from day one. Our service is completely free up to 1 million active users per month. So this is not just for the startups, but to enjoy, but everyone can get free access to CleverTap. So with that in mind, thank you. And if you have any questions, we'll be around after this. You can come ask Malcolm, myself, Jay, or Shawnee, and we'd be happy to answer any questions. And then I'd like to bring up Mario to introduce our panelists and Myriam for our team, who is our head of developer relations.
Good morning.
Take it over, Myriam.
I say good morning all the time. It's my way of dealing with time zones. So I got a cool panel here. Are my panelists ready? Is Will around? Where did he go? Come on up. Oh, there he is. Come on up, Will. So, I've got, here, you're going to need this. I'm going to introduce everyone, and we've got some interesting questions I think you'll really enjoy. So I'm Myriam Joire. I am the VP of Developer Relations for CleverTap. Some of you might know me from my time at Engadget. People recognize me all the time and go, can I see you in a video somewhere? And that would be the reason. So today we have three wonderful CEOs here. I'll start with Will, who's closer to me. Actually, I should sit next to you. Much more cozy this way. Cozy. Oh, is that okay? All right. Okay. So we've got Will Harbin here with Kixeye. And then next to Will, we have Felipe, Servin of Shoe Lovers. And then we have Rafael, Sanches of All the Cooks over there, far away. It's okay, you're not that far, actually. Do you guys want to introduce yourselves a little bit? Pitch what you do? Who's got the mic? There we go.
Testing. Hello.
It's working.
My name is Will Harbin, CEO of Kixeye. We're a game developer here in San Francisco. Been around for about 6 years. A few hundred people here in our U.S. offices and across Canada and Australia as well. Make an array of strategy war games on PC and mobile. Good to be here.
Hi there, my name is Felipe. I'm working in Shoe Lovers. Currently we have one of the biggest communities for shoe fashionistas on Facebook. We're using data analysis to create shoes on demand, but also to connect with all the people that love shoes.
Hi, I'm Rafa. I'm a CEO of All the Cooks. It's a recipe site. You guys should check it out. That's what I do.
Well, there you have it. Fastest pitches ever. These guys are pros. So, my first question for them was going to be to introduce themselves. That's been done. So let's jump right in. Growth is an important part of our businesses today. Any of you making apps will obviously want to grow your customer base and engage with your customer base. So let's talk about that a little bit. I'm going to throw a question at you. Maybe we can kind of go start at the end for a change. What were some of the key things you learned early on in terms of customer acquisition?
Be the number one. I think that's something that people think is very possible. But in my case, we focused on being number one for our recipes. So we wanted to be number one when we search for recipes. We wanted to have the best app. And if you're the number one in whatever you're doing, I think you should compare it with your competitors and not with Facebook or something unrealistic. So make sure you're number one in what you're doing, and if that's enough, if that's not enough, then it might not be doing the right thing.
Awesome. Felipe, what did you learn?
You know, when we start pitching to investors, normally we start with the, and some people here that listen to the pitch, normally we start with the, we have the answer for the $1 billion question, which is what women want. And then the best kind of bet was shoes, right?
Yes. Clearly.
Or at least that was our bet. And it's really important since the beginning of the company that we understood we need to create that persona, that specific person that can connect because of the voice, because of we are offering a kind of springs. But in a way we learn more about, she's a university person, she wants to be fashionista but with this kind of style. And also, she's using the mobile all the day to check whatever it is in her man. And you can identify that specific behaviors. You can try to create value in that loops. And I think that was the most important insight we have since the beginning.
Absolutely. Well, yeah, so the question was, what did you learn? What are the key things you learned about customer acquisitions early on?
So I can speak mostly direct paid acquisition. A lot of things. I mean, we've been doing paid acquisition since the inception of the company. But unfortunately right now it's a lot harder than it used to be. When we started acquiring customers, we acquired very good premium customers for a dollar a player. Now, you know, we've seen costs skyrocket to $5, $10, $15, $25. So a bunch of lessons learned. One, you need to do it yourself. You can't just be a good product builder, you gotta be a good marketer as well. Because if you give somebody third-party money and you don't know what you're doing, they're gonna take it. And this could go all the way up to $100 million. You got $100 million, there's someone out there who's gonna take it. You're not gonna get any qualified users if you don't know what you're doing. So you need to really micromanage the metrics and the KPIs from top to bottom. I mean, starting with CTR, with your conversion rates, make sure that you've got a great differentiated product that's got really good advertising. If you've got, you know, really high CTR, you're going to see your CPI lower and lower and lower than your competitors. It's not necessarily a zero-sum game when it comes to paid acquisition. So, you know, if you have a, you know, not all games are the same, not all apps are the same, and obviously if you've got, say, a recipe app competing with another recipe app, yeah, it's going to be a bit of a problem if you're coming into a market where there's already a lot of saturation. But for the most part, it's still a pretty big world, especially in mobile. We're dealing with millions, billions, and billions of eyeballs out there. So there is room for differentiated products to win, and differentiated products can win more of the paid marketing games. So differentiate yourself and learn to do it yourself.
So since I saw you on the mic, well, the next question is about, you know, the magic moments when you first launch your product.
It's very magical.
Right? People are super excited. You've got some delightful experiences. Onboarding is great. That's all nice, right? So the first week or so, you get all this acquisition of customers. How do you retain these in the long run? What have you learned about that? What's worked for you?
Well, and unfortunately, there's no magic trick. I mean, what I'm learning now, after 6 years of doing this, and still operating some of our games, and one of our most successful games, Battle Pirates, has been out since the beginning. We've been operating that for over 5 years now. And, you know, we've kind of been doing some larger macro A/B testing, kind of triangulate around different variables across four different titles to figure out what makes these things tick. I mean, to give you guys some context, what we focus on is really long-term, you know, ultra long-term retention. Now we have relatively niche targeted games. You know, for some of our earlier games, we'd have a 30-day retention rate of around, say, 4 to 5%. Now that's not a lot if you're looking at kind of a big mass market game where you're relying on virality, but for us, that 4-5% stays for 1 year, 2 years, 3 years, 4 years, 5 years. So to kind of get that flat engagement retention, you just have to keep laying the tracks down on your app or your game. And you know, there is no magic trick. So, you know, I think if you've got a good news is if you got really solid 1 day, 3 day, 7 day retention, you have a chance at building longer term engagement. You just have to keep developing your title. There is no secret to it other than just hard work. I think it's all kind of inherent to the content that you're making in the first place.
Felipe, what about you? What did you find works longer term to retain the customers that join you early on through magic?
Yeah, I think I can add something on the organic side of this. Pretty much, we have 33 million people in the community, but it's not only about reaching that 33 million people, but to reach more of that. At the end of the day, content that is making a value, that is creating a value for the user, is really powerful. We learned this in an aha moment, the first time we launched a video inside the community. It was original content, basically. So not anymore the kind of content that you can steal from YouTube and then put them back on Facebook because it's really funny. But actually, to create something that is helping that client, that change ended up attracting like a little more than 500 million people per month in our community. And it's not because it was a funny puppy or someone like a, I don't know.
No cat videos?
The thing is, the aha moment for us was exactly when we understood what is the user looking on social media. And then it's not anymore about this kind of vending machine where you put money on it and then you get the Coca-Cola. But it's a little more discovering and inspiring. In the way you can create value and inspiring people, you can engage a lot. And that's the secret of the virality we have right now.
Awesome. What about you? What's worked?
I think original and fresh content. Like if you have the best content that works kind of across many verticals too. Like just if you have something that's really good and keeps refreshing, that would work on long tail. I mean, for us, we invest most of our efforts into making fresh content.
No, that makes sense. I mean, it's the same with the media world. Evergreen content that comes back and gives value to your platform long term is definitely something that I think everyone benefits from. So what are you doing now that's different than when you first launched? This is for Rafael. Come back the other way here.
For me, is we started mobile only. So we started on Android, then we went for iOS, then we tried all the other platforms, mobile. And then, but now we are doing a lot of email. So trying to re-engage users with email and try to get those users who uninstall back. Have a large people who have registered to put their email in, and we never tapped into that. So now it's time to get those guys back.
Is that working for you, email?
Yeah, we have a huge like open rate and like conversion rates is like, we're iterating a lot to get that high up, and it's a lot of work.
Felipe, what are you doing now that's different than when you started?
I think the summer is only in two big things we're doing right now. At the beginning, we made a huge mistake trying to, because it's fancy to create your first iOS app, and then you're part of the body, and then everyone is like, rating because you have your app, and then you discover that you need to acquire and then you need to pay to any channel to bring app installation, right?
Right.
And we never analyzed that exactly our demographic is interacting on a web browser. It's mobile, but it's a web browser. because basically they are starting the interaction from Facebook, from some social media. They have the app, but then they have this kind of iframe where they're consuming the content, right? So you have this kind of obsession to send people to install your app. And then the most important thing is not to install your app, but basically to create value to them, to be able to connect and then sell the product.
Right.
But then, 2 years ago, it was like not that obvious anymore. That's the first one. The second one is about making this in a more intelligent way. Curation is part of the secret sauce. We were doing this with a lot of people, but basically it's really heavy to create an universe of fashion items. So the way we're doing now is working really well is to understand data. So basically we have an engine that is analyzing data trends, that is giving us what is the most powerful content out there in order to understand if pumps are the next big thing in the next few months. But then the machine is not the most important thing, because at the end of this, it's just about one feeling. Is if that kind of red pumps and making that huge passion when I'm watching that product. So the last mile of that creation is made by a human. So we're using the machine, then the human is the one telling the machine, you're wrong. And then that small difference combining technology to increase the creation process was a breakthrough on the road for us.
Cool. What about you, Will? What's different now from when you started out in terms of user engagement acquisitions?
Well, you know, we've gone through some kind of dips and valleys of change. I mean, I'd say that a couple of years after we got off the ground, well first kind of backing up, and we first started the business and launched our first kind of big hit, Backyard Monsters, we started to go on a tear of hyper growth, and we launched two more successive hits. And we got to a point where we thought, you know, we couldn't lose. So we did what any, you know, good startup in Silicon Valley does, we scaled. So we spent a whole hell of a lot of money. Thankfully, it was our own money, not an investor's money. It was all through cash flow. It's not where we didn't dig ourselves a big hole. So lesson number one, don't raise too much money. number two, make sure to scale methodically. At the end of the day, you know, business is all about one thing primarily, which is execution. The main thing that I try to hammer in all my product teams is there, what's the most important feature in a roadmap? Existence. That's the P0 feature. There's nothing more important than existence. I mean, obviously, you're going to make a piece of crap. You know, it doesn't matter if it exists or not, but let's make sure that we have some reasonable specs in there other than just existence. But we got ourselves into, you know, a bit of a problem where we started, you know, focusing on things other than execution, just throwing in every bell and whistle possible. We wasted $40 million on one title and killed it about a month after we launched it. So we certainly made our share of mistakes. So actually, I'd say now, you know, what we've done is try to refocus the way that we do development so that's actually more similar to what we do early. So, you know, I think that the big lesson here for anyone who's getting some early traction on their app or business or whatever is make sure to retain the magic around execution. Stay nimble, stay smart, and stay hungry. And don't let, you know, the third generation of people that you hired in the business tell you how to better run your business. You know how to do it because you're the one who got the business there in the first place, and trust your own instincts. So since we started doing that, we got back to launching games and we started being successful and profitable again. And so things have been hunky-dory. So focus on execution and don't let that go.
So on a related note, we're just going to zigzag back.
Great one.
Yeah.
Hold on.
no worries. So along those lines, can you identify some key like aha moments you had early on that stayed with you all this time that you still feel was like the right decision that and is just part of the growth of your business?
I mean, I think this
goes might not be able to, but
no, sure. I mean, this goes back to trusting your gut, and your gut is either right or it's not. So, you know, the good news is if you're right, you keep listening to it. If you were successful the first time, you're going to be successful again and again. So I think all the aha moments came from when we listened to ourselves and how we read the market. When we started in the marketplace, we came into a very crowded Facebook gaming ecosystem where everything was casual. It's like you had 101 rip-offs of various cow clickers, as we called them. And and when we said, hey, let's make a thoughtful game for kind of a more of a core gaming audience, people were like, that's the dumbest thing I've ever heard. That'll never work. Well, it worked. And I think, you just have to trust your gut and read the market yourself. I mean, can we get a show of hands? I don't even know who I'm talking to. We have game developers, app developers, entrepreneurs, marketers. So raise your hand if you're a game developer.
That's a good one. Who's here a game developer?
Nobody. Oh, all right.
Oh, you sir. Up there.
Come on up.
Who is an app developer here? Okay, a few. Core marketers. A few.
All right, I think I know what's going on here. Raise your hand if you're a recruiter. All right, so who are the rest of you guys?
Yeah, what are you guys doing? Anyway, we'll figure it out. But
don't we have some app intelligence that tags these people?
Yeah, maybe. No?
Okay, so. Anyway, where was I?
Aha moments.
Aha moments. So, let's say you're an entrepreneur, you're an app developer, whatever. Your business best, you know your market best, otherwise you wouldn't be in business. So if you got some traction, just keep on with that process of ideation and iteration. I think there's never any kind of a magic formula, but what you do have that works for you is an approach. So there's a big difference between a working approach versus some sort of secret recipe or formula. Formulas don't work, because that doesn't adapt to changing market conditions. So stick with an approach, and that'll serve you well if it worked a few times in the past.
So Felipe, I saw you nodding there. You agree, and what defined your moments that early on worked well, and that you were able to carry on into the business long term in terms of acquisition, customer happiness?
I think, I totally agree. You need to have your own intuition about the market. In that way, you have your first approach, and then you can iterate about that. Without that, you don't have a plan. You don't have that kind of the intuition that is telling you. You need to take that kind of market, or people is gonna use my app every day. So something that we ignored at the beginning was, and it's kind of funny. Now that we can see that to the past, it was the focus to the Hispanic market. And because once you have identified one opportunity on the market, and you have that extra information as a founder, but also you have previous experiences, in my case in the shoe business, you want to explain that to investors, but also to your clients. And it's really difficult if all the people is telling you why you're doing that. Right? You should just do money in US first, and then we'll see. But the thing is, back then, 2 years ago, we didn't know that currently the Hispanic market is the most powerful about buying power. They have like $1.5 trillion acquisition power. And they click 3 more times ads on Facebook than any other demographic. And they interact 4 times more than any other people on social media. So in the past it was like, we're focusing on Spanish just because we're really good on that and we can connect culturally. But then trying to adapt some product in order to be global is kind of a good insight. You need to go directly to that culture that you understand. I'm not talking about ethnicity, but I'm talking about that little tribes inside the market. If you're doing something for, something on sports, and you're so freak about soccer, you are the best to understand that culture, and because of that, you can talk to them directly. So I think the things that is still with us is the passion for solving a cultural approach. And at the beginning was the Latinas. Currently we are expanding to new demographics. But without the Latinas, we won't be this big or this engaged in the social landscape.
Awesome. So, Rafael, what about you guys? What works? Yeah.
I think my opinion is find a way to talk directly to, with your users every day. Like you can follow your gut and like, but still, like, if your user, like if you play the game, yeah, that's great. And you love it and you know it's going to work for everybody. In my case, I don't cook every day, but I'm building a product that's for people who are cooking every day. So I really, really need to be focused into listening to them and making sure that we're always like fixing whatever problem they are having, taking out the friction. And I think that's very challenging. Not everybody's able to connect with the users in a deeper level, and like kind of everyday conversation.
Sure. So speaking of your customers, you obviously have new customers that are coming on now every day, hopefully the hundreds of thousands. What about your long-term value customers, the ones that have been with you for a while? How do you treat them? Do you treat them differently? If so, what works? What have you identified works for you?
Yeah, those are exactly the users that we're in contact every day and make sure they're happy. Mm-hmm. Because they're the ones who are generating more value as a marketplace. So our company is basically a marketplace of where like people post recipes and other people can enjoy their recipes. So we focus only on those guys, making sure that they are happy all the time. Whatever they have a problem that's urgent for us.
So you could say you put more emphasis on making sure they're happy versus new customers, or I suppose you also have new customers?
Yeah, we know that if we have the best content, so the content generators, we put focus most on that. And then we know if they're creating like amazing viral content, then we're going to grow.
Gotcha.
Without them, we're nothing basically. We're only focused on the content generation people.
Cool. Felipe, what about you guys? Do you treat new customers differently? Do you have better, you know, ways of handling long-time customers?
I think it's a really difficult question because we're talking about fashion. Fashion and social media is like, you can actually choose something like easier, you know? And in terms of the people that is with us for a long time, it's really difficult to keep their attention. So everyone here understand that social media, Facebook, Twitter, whatever, you're just swiping content. You're swiping content, you are actually watching a lot of products in seconds. So the way that we are trying to attack this problem because it's a huge one for these kind of companies like shoelovers between content and e-commerce is basically split the community. And with the new customers, we have seconds to create something that they can fall in love right away because that's the kind of value we want to create on them. Once you can do that, you have around 3 days to keep the magic going. But it's totally different strategy for the people that is like 1 year with us.
All right, so how different is it what you do there?
For example, with the people that has more than 6 months with us, we try to push more content on daily life. In that way, we were talking before, we create content marketing, but it's something about, and that's really a huge topic inside the company, because commerce is not anymore about this vending machine where you put the money and then you take the product. It's more about this inspiration I was talking about. You need to create this content that is simplifying my life. It's like, what kind of trick I can do to fix my high heels if I'm in a party and then it's broken? That can become that. Sometimes it's happening in real world. And in that way, you can just being that kind of daily platform or daily source when you can find value all the time. And now it's a right in your week or in your day, different from new customer that you need to throw your whole army in order to convince them to be every day with you. So two big different strategies. Still, we're struggling with that. Hopefully, we can solve it.
So, how do you guys do it?
Treating people differently.
Yeah. Do you have a different approach communicating with very new clients, customers, versus the ones that people hear from?
Yeah. You've got to have everything tailored. I mean, the more mature you get. I'll give you some extreme examples. We have some players in our games that have spent north of $1 million a person. So we treat them no differently from the person that spends $5. Just kidding. Obviously people like that are going to get some special attention when they contact customer support. The thing that we've been struggling to deal with over the last couple of years is how do we deal with the person that has spent $0 but has spent 3 years playing the game? At some point, you have to understand that these people are costing you more money than they're making you. I mean, there absolutely is value for free players. They help the ecosystem, and they sometimes provide fodder for other players. So there is a point. And we do want, in the spirit of kind of free to play, we do want as many people to have fun with you as possible. So yes, we do offer tiered layers of support. And for us personally, if you've been playing the game for more than, 90 days. Been playing the game for more than 90 days and haven't spent over like $20, you're not going to get premium support. And simple as that. So it's at least restrict that kind of access around support. So in the world of scarce resources, it gets expensive. So that's one way around support. Around offers and kind of tailoring the game experience, we absolutely do have a set of heuristics and algorithms that determine what kind of offers to give people depending on the life cycle that they are in the game, and this applies to a variety of apps outside of products. I mean, you've got to have, I'm a big believer in contextual relevance. So whether it be offers or UI or whatever, things have to fit kind of the profile of the individual player. I think sometimes when you're a small team and you're so focused on executing, getting your app or website or game out, you only focus on kind of a narrow set of player or user scenarios because that's all the resources that you have. But as you get mature, you can't forget. I think for us in particular, we started only focused on laying the tracks as the game kind of went on. So we kept kind of what we call it feeding the whales that would keep playing the game and hopefully living on in perpetuity. But we also forgot about changing the early aspects of the game or the mid game relative to new users or newer kind of emerging and growing players in the game. So we had to go back and tailor that experience for a new set of kind of cohorts as well. So you got to be as dynamic and contextual as possible to survive as you scale. You can't, and that kind of going back at my earlier answer of what would you change or what have you changed since you have been in business a while, you do have to adapt some things, especially as you get kind of a more mature ecosystem of users, players, or what have you. You definitely need to be more dynamic.
So the next question for you, Will, is what types of content have you created to engage with the customers, if any, like videos, pictures, and what channels are you using? Obviously, probably in-game messaging, but perhaps Facebook, social media, other things. So, what do you explore? What do you use? What works?
You mean like in the game or marketing?
Both, like in general. This is content marketing. It can happen in your game.
Obviously, we're a content business. Everything that we do on a daily basis is creating more content, more features, and things like that in the app. But we certainly do a lot of video engagement, a lot of messaging on Twitter and Facebook, and in-game messages and app messages, push notifications, things like that. You got to utilize all of it. I wouldn't say there's any kind of silver bullet that's been most successful to us, and what works for us isn't going to work for you unless you're also making very niche core or strategy games for a particular audience, but you know, for us, we've done some very high production. We do relatively high production videos for almost every big content release that we have. We have a little video production, couple of video production studios in the office where we announce everything that we're doing and kind of build up a lot of hype. And we treat kind of most of these larger content releases like events that someone would attend in person. We set up event pages on Facebook and we invite people to those events to set up reminders and things like that. There's a lot of things that are at your disposal for free. I mean, now is there's never been a better time to do this kind of business than now. There's so many things. I mean, if, I don't know, if any of you were, you know, in business or trying to be an entrepreneur 15 years ago, it was expensive then. I mean, people were raising money to build infrastructure. Versus now, not only do you have, you know, infrastructure and bandwidth for dirt cheap, I mean, it's not even, you know, kind of a line item in your budget, but you've got everything at your disposal. I mean, Facebook offers an enormous number of tools, Twitter offers an enormous number of tools, YouTube, I mean, everything's at your disposal for free practically, and our product marketing costs are almost none except when we're doing direct marketing spend. So I'd say what we use as many media outlets as we're kind of media types as possible. Video has been successful for us. Just basic posts of images on Twitter and Facebook are successful. Instagram has not been successful for us. We don't see people engaging with products just yet on channels like Instagram, but you know, just try stuff.
What about you, Felipe? You've got some stories about Facebook. I've heard rumors. So, you know, what works? What kind of content do you produce and create for marketing, and what channels do you put it on?
We are giving away shoes for free.
Wow.
And
signing up right now.
It's working really well. Contest are working really well with us. Basically, social media, we are focused totally on social media. Contests and surveys are really powerful in order to increase organically the user acquisition. I need to mention that this community was built totally in an organic way. That means we haven't spent money on Facebook talking about bringing users to that. And we have the same kind of approach. We are creating video. We have our video production team in Colombia. Currently, we have the capacity to create around 100 original videos every month. And with that is like the cycle of creating new value for the user. So social media is working really well. Talking about Instagram, I need to disagree. Instagram is working well, you know, in terms of sales. And that's because Instagram is just new. The new mechanism to launch a lot of ads on Instagram is not taken by a lot of brands. With this, I mean, it's just that untapped market that no one is taking. Now it's really cheap, and it's not gonna stay there for a long time. So, for example, if you have your plan for Christmas, I would consider some budget for Instagram right now, because maybe this is the last Christmas you can pay that fee for acquisition on that channel. So media, Facebook, Instagram, we are totally out of Pinterest, because Pinterest for us is just, it's a huge universe of content on Pinterest. And then you can see between phrases to one puppy to one person's shoes. So it's like, give me a second. There's a lot of options there that your mind is like, wait, so why I'm here? So in the way you can focus the main call to action in one channel you have, in the way you can reduce friction but also noise in the experience, It's a really good way, whatever the channel. For us, media, social media is working really well.
Yeah, you were talking about Facebook earlier, right? In the meeting earlier. Tell us a little bit more about that, your experience with Facebook.
There's a small story about how people is talking about organic reach on Facebook. basically the experts, once we launched the product, they were like, you know, Facebook is giving the organic reach. Basically, the global average is 2 to 5% of the size of your community. So basically, you are doomed, and you're gonna die. Well, 2 years after that, we proved that we have a reach of 800% of the current size of the community, number 2 or 5. And the secret is really, really simple. Facebook has changed a lot in the way they evaluate you as a brand. And the rule of thumb is just, they are tracking your history. So basically, if you're a brand that continuously is creating content and value to the people, they know that. And then if you are releasing like 10 posts per day, and between that 10, 9 are engaging people, that means you're doing something well. And then Facebook is taking care of that. So you are having these kind of little points every day, and then the age rank, which is totally different now, is considering you as a constant brand. So in that way, talking about these experts that were saying that 2% is something that that's the top of the industry, and that's bullshit. You need to focus.
Yeah, well, there's a tip from a pro. Rafael, tell us about the media you use, the content you create, if any, and what channels you put it on to engage with your customers.
Right. I spent a lot of time building kind of a social network between the app. And our biggest thing is like when you cook something, you take a photo of it, and then the author of the recipe reply back to you. And that's what the loop, kind of like this beautiful loop where when you go to eat at someone's house, he cooks for you, and you're smiling, he's smiling, everybody's smiling. Creates this magical moment. And then whenever a user has a problem or anything, they contact him. Direct messages, we have forums and all the stuff in the app. And of course, email and everything else.
Cool. So related question. You all have apps, right? In your games. You have an app, yes, and you have an app. So how do you handle people deleting or uninstalling the app? Do you have a mechanism in place to follow up with them?
Yeah, right now we're like experimenting a lot of reconverting them with email, trying to subscribe them to this daily newsletter or everything that's a daily basis. Try to make them come back, all the kind of stuff, it's really good. I think email, like collecting email early is powerful. I think if you can collect email very early, that's a mistake we did in the beginning, where we facilitated a lot, like to users to start creating content because that's what we needed as a marketplace. So we needed recipes, we prioritized the recipes, but then later on we didn't have all the email of all these people. So, but you know, having the email early is really important. So you can reach back.
Felipe, what do you guys do when people are installing the app? Are you able to reach out to them? Do you have a strategy for that?
Yeah, I think that's the best part of your insight. You need to have a channel to talk back to them. For example, with us, some of the experiments we're doing right now with really nice like return is SMS. Because it's weird, now it's trendy to be retro. So
yeah, well, you probably have a pretty good traction with text messaging in Latin America, right?
Yeah, and it's because, I mean, how many SMS you're receiving like every day?
It's, right.
It's so weird, and then you're like, what, an SMS? And it's so personal, because it's not anymore the person took the time to write your name and then send you an SMS. So talking about open rate, it's really, really magical. It's close to 90% of open rate, and then the call to action is close to 80%. So people actually pay attention to SMS currently. Even there is one company here in Rocket Space doing hair extensions called Maven. Maven built their empire based on SMS. creating a flow to have the customer care service on SMS, the buying process, everything on that. And then it was one of the insights we want to try. SMS is working really well to bring people back to use our service.
Well, what's your strategy when people decide to delete the apps or the games?
I send each user a guilt-laden email begging them to come back.
I was going to say, maybe...
It never works, so then I send edible arrangements.
You sit there, man. So,
honestly, for the most part, I found it to be a complete lost cause. It can be really expensive. I mean, once somebody actually uninstalls your app, they forget about it. They're uninstalling it for a reason. So, if you really want to go down the path of how to optimize that, and if you've got good enough data, you can figure out something around what's the last thing they did prior to uninstalling your app, for the crashes or the bugs that are your fault. If they were spending and one of our games prior, we could hit them up with a special offer. Maybe the game got too expensive for them, or we wanted to adjust something, you can try that stuff. But for the most part, you should really be focusing on making sure people don't uninstall your app. Because once they're gone, they're probably going to be really gone.
I think that's very good advice. So we're almost done, and I don't want you to fall asleep. But last quick question that you can just rapid fire answer each and you can start with is, if there's one piece of advice to give these wonderful people out here in terms of being an entrepreneur, doing what you do, what's the thing?
A lot of people say the secret to success is to not give up. And I think sometimes that's actually bad advice. I think really you need to know when to give up and when not to give up. And a lot of that comes down to managing your own psychology. And for me, over the last 6 years, and this has been a big kind of journey for me, I've found a lot of companies and a lot of successes, but this has been definitely one of the hardest successes. I feel like I've really earned it every step of the way. And a lot of it has really just been fighting and dealing with my own psychology and kind of taking a step back and trying to separate my own psychology from reality. And that's a real important concept. And this is talked about a lot in various business books and psychology books as well. And I think it's worth your time investing in yourself and thinking about how to manage your own psychology and the psychology of others that you're working with, especially if you're about to embark upon an entrepreneurial endeavor. To be a little bit more specific, sometimes times get really tough and it's hard and the walls are kind of crashing in on you. And a lot of that can be a bit self-inflicted. Imagine, if you're starting a company, you're probably a type A personality, you're an overachiever, you expect a lot of yourselves and a lot from others, and you're probably your toughest critic. And sometimes you just need to lighten the fuck up. So, my advice is lighten the fuck up.
Felipe, what's your advice?
In our experience, it's all about passion. So I would say this is really a cliche about follow your passion. I would add to that you need to understand what is your passion as a leader or as an entrepreneur. But also you need to understand what is the passion of your client, because in that way you need to have this kind of quick assessment on, is my passion aligned with the user I want to create value or not? Because maybe I'm a big, it's a hardcore gamer profile, right? And I want to do something cooking, which is not making sense at all. But then I mean, maybe you're not cooking all the time, but you feel the pleasure to help other people that wants to do that. So the passion of the user or the market, making sense with the passion you have personally will be something, and do not forget that since the beginning.
Passionate people are infectious, it's true. Rafael, what's your tip?
Align the passion and never give up.
Don't give up. Awesome. So listen, we're almost about ready for Q&A. There's a couple of things I want want to do. If you guys want to come back and like maybe just let people know where they can find your product, your company, where they can find the app, that'd be great. Go ahead. Obviously, it's going to be on the stores, but if you have a URL, you can share it or something.
Search for recipes. Download.
You can find more shoes on shoelovers.co. And also, any kind of question or quick doubts about how we're connecting with the Hispanic market, you can find me on Twitter with F Servin, my last name, and then pretty happy to help.
Well,
Kixeye.com.
There you go. So, before I touch on you, I just want to let you know, later on we're going to be bling, right, hopefully. We do content creation at CleverTap, and I do a thing called CleverTap TV. It's basically a YouTube series where I interview you, I put my media shots hat, my media hat on, and I interview you about your startup, about your product, about your app. So come and see me if you're interested in talking to me. I like to showcase cool new apps and ask you about how you engage with your customers. So come and get me afterwards. And now it's time for Q&A, Mario.
Yeah.
Are we just going to jump in and run in?
Yeah, if you want me to be the runner, or if you guys have a question, ask a question, that statement, we'll cut you off.
Why don't you have my mic for this?
Yeah,
you want me to run? Here.
Yeah, you guys have the mic? No, I'll run. Okay, who's got a question? Question? You got one?
From the audience. So my question is, can you give us a specific of how you use data in your marketing?
That's all that we do. So.
So, segmentation, personas.
Yes. anything you can imagine, we probably do. So, profiling people, market segments, every way that we can scan it, and we try to associate to positive KPIs in our products, and we try to acquire more of those people. So, and we've got to be really adept at data to ever be successful in this market, which is being more crowded at the moment. I mean, the days of coming up with, I mean, I'm sure someone's going to come up with some incredibly viral app that nobody ever thought of, but we don't rely on virality at all, because it's something that you can't control. We rely on data-driven marketing, so if you're really good at that, you've always got a lever to pull.
On that one, I need to disagree. Virality, it has a set of factors you can put together to create the beginning of that wheel spinning. In our side, we have a little framework to create a virality, and it's based on data. The data is really expensive when you are starting a company, because as he mentioned, you have a lot of options to implement segments, retargeting, creating the persona, but then the best way to do that is prioritize between that many data approaches, which one is going to create the most impact to your experience or to your bank account. That simple. For us, a simple example about it is we create fashion personas. So in that way we know if you are a rocker, if you are a chic, if you have trendy outfits, kind of style. And in that way we can create the best set of products but also content in order to create what you love and what you like.
I think this is pretty good. We don't market, just organic.
Next question.
All right.
First of all, thank you for all your answers, very insightful. In terms of user profiles, can you share the percentage breakdowns between iOS and Android? I'm just curious because there's a variety of different businesses out there. I'm curious what the percentage breakdowns are between those two.
It depends on your country you're launching that. For example, in Latin America, Android is the big leader. is taking between 70 to 75% of the engaged users. It's cheaper to attract them on ads, but also it has a dilemma on that, which is people with an iPhone, it has less friction to complete transactions. So the kind of decision you need to do on that is if all the people you are serving on Android are value enough to your business and to the whole experience to invest in that, or just focus on the new market that is ready to buy. So it's between you are in the way to create money, that's it, or it's a combination between experience and money. It's a hard question.
Rafael, are you all Windows users?
Yeah, I have some. Okay. Yeah, I mean, our biggest market is Android and iOS too. Yeah.
So we're split at probably about 60% usage in favor of Android and also revenue as well. It's a little bit different than other game makers. I don't know, skews. I think the more casual games skew a little bit more on iOS, we're skewing a little bit more on Android, and that's a new development.
Great. Who's going to be next?
So this question is, I guess for all three, but for Will specifically, since he has a larger company that's been around a while, and you have a lot of teams. So I used to hear a lot about how, you know, finding the right talent was always the big headache around here, and I'm not hearing that as much. And to me, that in the case, perhaps, the industry maybe has hit a plateau, things have slowed down a little bit, maybe in the case of your business, you have the teams you need, you've got some loyal engineers working for you. So is that still a big problem with your business, is getting the right people, the right talent?
It's not as big as it was simply because we chose to diversify away from San Francisco. I mean, honestly, once you get to a certain size in San Francisco, it is too expensive. You should not scale further in San Francisco. This is a small, expensive as hell market. And you know, one of my engineers in Brisbane, Australia, is just as talented as one of my engineers in San Francisco, but they're 60%, 50% cheaper.
Mean geographically, just in general, wherever you're finding your engineers?
I mean, just in general, I think there has been a slowdown. I mean, the majority of kind of the crazy hiring that was going on in San Francisco, and I think we're going to find things that come to a screeching halt in the employment market within the next 18 months in San Francisco especially, maybe sooner, because the majority of the hiring was funded by private investment. Most of these companies weren't profitable, they have no chance of being profitable, and just these absurd offers. I mean, I've had mid-level product managers hired away for $300,000 base salaries. That's bullshit. That's not sustainable. And that's from companies that aren't making a profit. So maybe they can figure it out. I mean, maybe I'm the stupid.
What I was driving at in your case, though, was just finding the right type of talent, like engineers and understanding gaming, marketing, gaming. Do you think there's
you got to cast a wide net.
Out of schools, or are there more of them coming out of schools to meet that demand?
No, they're not more coming out of schools. I mean, we have a big education problem in this country. That's for sure. So, and that's why there are many reasons. So I think the market is tight in San Francisco for one. It's getting a bit better, but we do have a top of the funnel problem, kind of starting with the education system in this country, especially. So we've set up offices in Canada and Europe and in Australia and buying Asia as well. But as soon as you get to it, and this is kind of what I was talking about earlier about some of the mistakes that we made when we were scaling, you got to start doing some things differently. You can't just keep kind of laying tracks on linear direction. You got to think about things differently. It's like, okay, well, let's hire another 5 people here, another 10 people here, and then all of a sudden, I'm going to add another 300 people here, and trying to do it the same way in the same location is stupid. So always figure out how to do more with less. And when you have to add more people, look at the most cost efficient, most productive way to do it. San Francisco is not always the answer.
Felipe, Rafael, any feedback on
comments?
Yeah, you had me. No, you research issues?
Pretty much it's kind of the same trend. It's very hard and harder to hire people here with the talent you need. We're a global company, so basically we discovered that fashion curation is really strong in Argentina. That's why we have the fashion team there. Video creation is really nice in Colombia because of the presenters' talent, but also videographers. And we have a nice, super nice team of developers in Mexico City, besides the core team we have here in the valley. So pretty much you go where you can find the talent. I mean, we have a lot of technology to connect teams. In the way we can manage the distribution of the team, we can improve the outcome of the whole company.
We can't afford to hire in San Francisco, but I think it's still affordable to find people in the US. So we can get from Reno, we can get people, we can be creative with that, like get young people and train them, do all that kind of stuff. But that being said, like we have a large amount of people in Brazil, and we'll keep bringing them.
Cool. All right, next question.
My question is more about, this is more specifically related to shopping and engagement in general. So one of the questions, entrepreneurs who are starting out have is, what's the best way to, make sure you start with the product line and move into shopping, which is engaging the customer the most. So on the website, today it's come to a point where, people are really narrowing down on the niche. Like before it used to be, say shoes and, product like Amazon came out and examples. And then now they're really narrowed down, like supply of mine, really specific niches. How is it on the mobile side? Is it best for people who are starting out to go broad versus narrow, and how do you make that choice? And how do you maybe like do some kind of testing? Like on the website, you do some affiliate tests and things like that. How is the strategy different on the mobile versus mobile?
Basically, we try the affiliate model some months ago, more than a year ago. And then the biggest problem with that was something that we knew since the beginning. And I'm trying to say this over and over again in this speech, because we totally ignore that the most important thing is the experience. So considering the affiliate model, if you are that influencer that is creating that amazing discovery experience, it's just not making sense that at the end of the experience you are sending me to finish the transaction with another guy. It's like you make the whole seduction phase, and then another one is gonna sell me something that, and it's not mobile optimized. It's like, what the fuck, right? So the whole flow in the experience is really important. That doesn't mean that you need to create the whole logistics process, but then at least you need to have the front end and the interactions with the user really well defined and in your ownership, because in that way you can measure a lot of things. Once it's in the user in another property, you will know what happened.
Do we have time for another question?
One more question, guys. I think over here. Is it?
Yeah. Okay, go ahead. So my question is, you all know digital marketing is more and more important now, but the problem is that we can't always come up with so good enough content. So if we want to differentiate us from other like competitors, shall we try to do it at the very beginning stage, or do we like target more at a long run goal to see that we want to be the most
of the
one in the competition?
I don't think I understand. Do you hear that?
No, can you repeat the question? I'm not quite sure we got it up here.
My question is, for example, if I have a startup now and I want to differentiate my product from my competitors, from So should I do it, like I release every content I have now to try to differentiate my products at the beginning startup stage, or should we like keep some stuff till a later stage to a long run competition?
So you're saying, should you release everything you have in a fury of content rage now versus later? Is that correct?
Yes.
Basically. So, I mean, I have to know specifically what your product is, but I don't think that it, like, I mean, you can only think of a finite set of features or product for your service or whatever. Maybe that's not the best business, but hopefully you're selling yourself short a little bit and you can think of more. But I mean, obviously, look, if your product's not working at first, then it's not working. So keep throwing stuff at it until it works. I mean, there's no sense in kind of holding back for later. But if the question is, you know, what should you be doing past kind of the first elements of engagement, the first 7 days of like consumer life cycle, you gotta keep it up. I mean, we release stuff at least once a week for each product. So, you know, if it's not working, it's not working, it's one thing. But you shouldn't just arbitrarily hold back even when it's still not working. So make it work first in this first 7 days, and then keep doing everything until you die to make the rest of it work.
Felipe, Rafael, any wise last words before we conclude this beautiful event?
Talking about content and then linking that to the question is, I think you just do it. Just launch it, you know? Make it, if you haven't, just do it. And then you will see if it's working or not. Because you have a lot of hypotheses and the market will tell you. So in the worst case scenario, you invest thousands of dollars creating that, and then you was like, fuck, I should bring more, I don't know, acquisition or pay that extra engineer I need. But if you already have it, just do it.
If you can keep it fresh, yeah, just do it. I agree with both.
Yeah, I think I'm just gonna add something to that. You know, having worked in, when I was at Pebble, doing communications and evangelism for them, you know, one of my jobs was to keep the media buzz going. And to do that, you can't show all your cards all the time. You have to keep some stuff for later, because there are times when you don't have necessarily a new product, you just have updates and other things. So, you know, just be strategic about how you roll out your content. I think that's what I would say. So anyway, are we good?
We're good.
Should we wrap it up and just like get some more drinks and food? And... Okay, well, I want to thank you guys for all being here. Will, thank you, Felipe, thank you, Rafael. It's been a pleasure. Mingle and talk with us and ask us questions. Remember, if you want to be on CleverTap TV, come and get me.